308. And we'll move right on down to Betty. Go ahead.
I'm gonna do it quick.
Yeah, we're quick.
All right. Well, I sent and handed out to you the notes from the last meeting. And the last version that I offered, gave you this morning, or this afternoon, includes some of my edits that kind of goes through this. But what I wanted to do today is basically, you pretty much agreed that the mission statement that you had, you reaffirmed that that is the mission statement, and so we're not making any changes to that. So I wanted to then review and adopt the vision statement. So I went through and took all of the thoughts that you had and put it into a statement. So I want to go through that and see if that really fits with what you were thinking.
Could you turn that a little bit more?
Oh, yes,
sure. Thank you.
Uh-huh. And then we need to kind of go through the objectives that the goals and then the objectives. And the goal statements, I restated several of them to make them more specific goals rather than, some of them were kind of just things, projects, more than they were goals. So I went through and kind of added into that also. So I want to make sure that I'm still on the right track with what you were thinking. And then we really need to go through those and look at what are the priorities and where are you going to start? You know, is it more than you can take on all at once, or is it possible? And is there anything that we didn't include that you've thought about since the last meeting? So we'll go through those goal statements, review the objectives, and then the final part really is kind of setting some targets for yourself. And I don't know if you read through kind of that, the information I gave you from last time, but one thing it says that you really need to do to hold yourselves accountable is to really set some targets so that you know that you're actually, you know, it's great to go through this process, but it just gets pushed off and it sits on a shelf. So if you really set some targets of things that you want to accomplish, and then I have an implementation plan that we can go through that can kind of help you go through that process as you're doing this. So, anything else? Does anyone, you know, did anyone have any thoughts after the last meeting of something that you wanted to make sure we didn't lose anything, or just kind of continue with what I've got up here?
We'll probably think of something as we go along.
I have great thoughts at 3 o'clock in the morning, but I never remember what they are in the next morning. But they're really brilliant when I have them in the middle of the night. Okay, so the first thing, you know, we went through kind of what your visions were. We just did some, you know, some brain dump type of things, and you talked about growth, more people, extending your boundaries, your youth returning, appropriate housing, expanded educational opportunities, including preschool, which is needed, more health services and other services, and then reinvestment in both commercial and residential. So I'm suggesting to you that your vision is Lakeview is a revitalized and growing community that offers a variety of business services, housing, and educational opportunities while maintaining our cultural heritage and family connections.
I like that.
So, I don't often ask for wordsmithing because it's kind of hard to do group write, but does that capture kind of the thoughts that you were wanting out there as a vision statement?
I think it encompasses, I can't think of what you might have left out off the top of my head, in other words, but
I was trying to get to both, you know, the housing aspect of it, because really you did talk quite a bit about the need for that, improving the housing and making sure there was a variety of housing options, and also having those educational opportunities is something that is was important that you were talking about, so I tried to capture that in there. But then you also, as your values, wanted to make sure that your heritage and your sense of family is really kind of that, where you're at as a community as much, and should kind of be one of those gauges you look at. Is what we're doing still, you know, a kind of family-friendly or focused on that? So if no one has any changes to that, we may...
So I do.
Okay.
So I hate's a strong word. I don't like it when we have past tense things.
Oh, sure.
So actually, I would use revitalizing.
Okay.
Instead of revitalize, because we're continuing to revitalize.
Uh-huh.
And I would almost say that we're an economic growing community.
Okay.
Because, which is then going to provide for business opportunities and you know, housing and educational opportunities. So business, housing, and economic. So I just get rid of services because, I mean,
right.
That's
okay.
Implied, I guess. But, and I think we need to focus on, those key
okay.
areas as opportunities. But other than that, I mean, I like it.
So you added the word economically growing, is that?
Yeah, economically growing, because...
Okay.
Like, when we look at our housing actual index and stuff like that, we are not growing.
I know.
We're actually declining. So I don't want to be necessarily misleading, I mean, but economically-wise, we are growing.
Right.
So, which is providing these housing and all the opportunities. Yeah.
So I agree. I actually don't like the past tense either, but
but revitalizing is
revitalizing
as much as revitalizing.
An economically growing community that offers a variety of business, housing, and educational opportunities while maintaining our cultural heritage and family connections. So,
which touches on, the educational certainly touches on like KCC and stuff
mm-hmm.
like that.
And a lot of it is, you know, going through and kind of looking at what you've talked about, there's a lot of partnerships that are going to be, I think, important, but, okay. So the values, did anyone have anything to add into the value statements at all? They're not necessarily in a priority order, and I can go through and alphabetize them, which would kind of take a little bit of a that and make them look a little more random, I think, as far as they go. But and would also basically put your community and culture up more to the top. But does anyone have any thoughts along that line? Okay, so your change agenda, basically now, small businesses struggling, your future, you want to see space appropriate for growth of small businesses. I didn't have an offset for hidden gems, and I guess I couldn't really remember the conversation. So hidden gems, I believe, means that you've got a lot of places, and that was something that I couldn't quite remember where that conversation was heading when we discussed that one.
I don't remember exactly either, but, I guess it's just maybe I don't think of things in town so much as things out of town that people would come here to see that aren't well known.
So it's a little bit the tourist attraction type
right.
of things?
Yeah.
Okay. So really what that is getting at is that you're wanting to make sure that you're promoting?
Yeah.
You're,
Expanding
and promoting your tourism? Okay. Oops. Which is an effort that's going on.
Yeah. And I think it definitely includes those that are just barely outside of town limits,
mm-hmm.
stuff like the ski hill. when I think of expanding, I'm thinking about having that chairlift open during the summer times and getting bikers with their bikes up and, you know, handling around through the hills all back downtown and things like that, so.
Yeah, there's a lot of opportunities there. It's just kind of a matter of the promotion and somebody who's has that entrepreneurial spirit that wants to kind of take that on too. It's, you know, although the Warner Ski Park is a nonprofit organization.
It is. It's
all right, and then we talked about properties beyond repair or blighted. And your future goal is a revitalized community with less vacant properties and kind of cleaned up and spruced up. You have little new development happening now. You want new investment into the community. You had, oh, not shortish.
Sorry.
Yeah, I know it says shortest. A shortest of local services. I need to get my spell check out. And what you want more of is more shopping local and more local spend and opportunities. You need, and specifically called out, need more preschool options. So in your future, you have more preschool options, and I'm not sure what role, you know, you as a council take, but that I think is an important consideration for going into the future. So when you talked about goals last time, you said the goal is water filtration system improvement completed. To me, the goal is providing and maintaining infrastructure improvements necessary for growth is what the goal is, and number one priority under that is the water system, because I think eventually you'll have other infrastructure needs that you need to address. But is that, am I overstepping? Am I making it too broad?
Well, no, I think that is our number one thing, because well, the reputation is pretty bad.
Well, and with Red Rock coming in and stuff, we're going to have to be doing some. I was just in meetings this morning on expanding, maybe possibly our sewer lagoons, because they're going to have some discharge and we need a place to put it, so we may have to put another lagoon in. With their help, you know, they'll be helping us through that, but the sewer also needs some work on it too, so I think that's something to keep in mind.
Yeah, so, the goals are kind of longer term, I think, you know, as far as ongoing, you're always looking at infrastructure needs.
Whether geothermal or
right,
sewer.
Exactly. Or, yeah. Yeah, and that did kind of get to, you know, the comment that we had about making sure that we're using the assets that you have.
Yeah, yeah.
So providing and maintaining infrastructure improvements necessary for growth. Okay, the second goal I restated is promote a climate that supports business creation and vitality while recognizing the special needs of small business owners and agriculture. And I included the agriculture in there because you did identify that you are a hub for the greater area, you know, as far as the agricultural community and for that. So that's kind of a broader goal, but it did talk to really what you were getting at, really making sure that we were paying attention to what the needs of businesses were. You specifically identified the workforce issues that you have, but also, you know, you talked somewhat about making sure that we had the appropriate spaces for people and things like that. So that broader goal is kind of a little bit more, but it gets you more towards that business-friendly community concept that then goes back to your vision of growing economically. So I'm trying to restate things without putting words in your mouth, and so I'm hoping that I got there. The other one, and I don't know the verb you want to use, because this is, do you want to encourage, do you want to support, or do you want to, you know, business and economic growth in partnership with regional economic development organizations? And the reason I'm saying regional, because that you're talking KCC, SCOED, the Small Business Development Center, almost all of the organizations you work with here in this community are regional in scope, so even, you know, your work source folks and everything else are both Klamath and Lake. So that was kind of getting more towards the opportunity to partner with others to really emphasize building your workforce up and your educational opportunities at the same time.
I think both words are good.
Encourage and support.
And support. Yeah. Okay, I just didn't, because you will, it will be interpreted when you say support that there will be, you know, that you're part of money.
We put in parentheses, yeah, not financially.
That's why I wasn't sure if you wanted to.
So, I mean, it's our goal to do this. I mean, it's currently happening, so that's why I'd almost continue to encourage and fund.
Okay.
Continue to do these things, because we are doing these things.
Well, I know that.
Part of our ongoing goals.
Yes, you do.
And I almost wonder if we want to call out, like, Regional Solutions and Business Morgan as well on this list.
Right, well, yes.
With KCC and WorkSource, because, I mean, I think that they're definitely key partners that we are working with, so.
So continue to
encourage.
Okay. I left kind of improve parks and activities or improve parks and activities for youth by investing in capital improvements. That's the goal is really the investment into those types of things. And then identify and provide incentives for community revitalization and housing rehabilitation. So those incentives you haven't really identified, but you know, that kind of gets to that wanting to make sure that there's something out there to encourage people to reinvest. So again, that's
Do we want to touch on anything about air quality here?
That was one of the questions I had, because I know that there are some things that didn't come up at the last meeting that we may need to capture somewhere.
I think it'd be nice to have a goal in line with, you know, keeping within the air quality standard, the 2.5 standard, and seeking to encourage reducing our air. Something, we'll have to wordsmith that a little bit more, but something along those lines.
So I heard we
can look at the plan, and there's probably something in the plan that there might be a goal statement actually in the plan that we can just copy and paste into this. But it's our committee, so, and it's of huge importance to
it was encouraged the it's the air quality.
Copy of the plan so much. Does Don have it? You didn't run over there. Beans, I'll run up there.
So really, the goal is to meet. You want to meet the air quality.
Yeah, to meet the air quality standards.
Okay.
Yeah.
Or continue.
Continue. Yeah. We've done a pretty good job of that. It's been very difficult over the years.
And I know there's probably another 100 Woodstones that probably need to be come out, but we did get 200 of them out.
Yeah.
But there are still more.
Really helped a great deal. I know several people that got changeovers and were really happy with it.
Well, we have looked for more money, but we haven't really identified it. But I know that that is something that. So who needs to be encouraged? Is it the citizens? That's kind of where.
Burn wise, stuff like that.
So
I think it should be continued to encourage citizens.
We've been.
I think most people have done a fairly decent job of finally getting into the red green lights and
So are you using, because a part of what we were able to fund were like the fire stations and the fairground has the green and red, so you're using those.
Yeah.
people are.
People are looking at those and not commenting if something isn't on.
Okay. So wasn't the fairgrounds, I'm not sure the park, only red or only shows if it's red?
Oh, yeah.
I never looked at the fairgrounds.
I drive by and I probably don't see it, but I was told that it only shows if it's a red day, not the other days.
The dime, because otherwise they have others.
Because if it's a yellow day, that means some people can't.
Yeah, and, but just having that, getting people used to kind of watching for that and having that information out there. The other thing that, that they do well over in Plymouth with Facebook even is just announcing.
Oh, they do that too.
Do you do that?
Okay, every day.
Good, so that, you know, kind of, because there's a lot of people who are on Facebook all the time.
Yeah, we have the phone that people can call in and then we have the Facebook and then we put a flag out front and then the two reader boards depending on, you know, and then the upstairs stoplight.
And the radio, right?
And isn't on the town.
Do we change it on the radio every day or do you just on?
We run announcements every day, but we just change it on yellow and red days.
Okay.
The days that we really.
Really good, okay.
Schedule, Debbie.
So we've got a lot.
No lack of dissemination of information.
Yeah.
And you do still have some of your loan program funding, right, for folks to help with that? So you, knowing that getting that information out. So is there a standard, or we can, maybe when we get to the implementation, we'll come up with that standard itself. All right, so we're adding this to the goals. Anything else? I mean, this is kind of, we're working on infrastructure improvements. You are promoting a good business climate for economic growth. You're encouraging partnerships to help with those workforce issues and other things that are out there that need worked on regionally. You're improving your parks. You're identifying incentives for community revitalization and housing rehab. And community revitalization, in my mind, I was lumping in commercial, your downtown, and then the housing side of things, both. Am I correct on that? Does that need to be clarified a little more?
We wanted both of those pretty well covered.
Yeah. And then continue to encourage citizens to meet air quality standards so that you can retain your existing businesses. And
really, it's not on here, but you know, just actual housing, promote housing.
Well, that, yeah, and that was one that I was wondering if you wanted a stronger statement on that, promote availability of housing options or.
Yeah, because. We've got plenty of housing. I don't know how, but we've got.
I saw on the paper today that the state legislature is maybe going to change the laws so that you can build more apartments, well, two-family or three-family dwellings instead of one family in an area. But that may be a while before that happens. But which, because of the voting shortage, is. The state, not just Lakeview.
It is. Yeah. I mean, the state has a shortage of housing all over. It is more of a issue for rural communities who don't have the values in the homes to be able to encourage new investment. And actually, starting tomorrow afternoon and for a day and a half, I'm participating in a workforce housing task force over in Klamath County that is made up of realtors and folks from the community, and it's really more the community-based people that are really seeing that they need to do something. So I can share some of that with you too after, but there is some opportunities I think that is coming down through the state that we can that you can take advantage of too. So that was the one, and I did, like I said, I'm trying not to put words in your mouth, but I really know from a lot of discussions that having those housing options is important, especially now that you do have some new jobs coming into the community and you have a lot of people that are looking for housing right now. So you have that need almost immediately. Your housing plan outreach meeting is tomorrow, right?
Tomorrow.
Yep.
At noon, is it noon? 1 o'clock, 1 o'clock, I don't know.
Yeah, it goes like that, and then at 6 to 8.
Yeah.
So there's two tomorrow.
Committee first.
So that is the first step. I have had conversations with the state DLCD about the concerns that you have and that we have in Klamath, that the Portland State studies do not take into consideration the anecdotal and real potential for growth that you have that can happen without housing. And so they're really looking at that and trying to identify ways that you can do, make sure that that message gets out there.
Well, those are updated every, you know, 3 or 4 years, you can't remember mm-hmm. which, but you know, by the time everything's really in the ground, it'll be about time to have a really new population forecast. And they'll be prepared, I'm sure. In about 2 more years, it's going to be prepared, so.
So, to implement or to really, you know, the objectives underneath your goals, then your provide, maintain infrastructure improvements. Your number one was your water filtration system improvements, securing the funding, getting your rate structure determined and approved by the community, and then kind of just following your timeline, developing and following the timeline on that. Are there any other things that need to happen to kind of keep that moving and on track? And that is, and I'll come back to prioritizing here in a minute. Okay, the second one we talked about was improving parks and recreation. That was what the note said was to convene a steering committee with partners, and you included the schools, the hospital, and the community groups, because I'm sure there's baseball and Little League and all others out there that want to be part of that, to gather public input and develop a strategy and a project list. So it's not, you've got a master plan, but do you have a priority list of where to start and what projects, you know, should, I know that there's this discussion on this, you know, the park, you know, the
Kiddie pool, and the public
swimming
pool.
Mm-hmm. Now, in that recreation master plan that was finished 4 years ago at this point in time, there was discussion of forming a park and rec district. So is that something you still want to kind of have somebody work on doing that or look at the feasibility of that? Or where do you think that is? Is that more of a gauging the community's interest in taxing themselves more? Or is that just putting it on a ballot?
Question. I'm not sure.
Maybe we need to probably look at that plan.
It's been a while since we talked about it.
In 4 years, there's been a lot of change, and mm-hmm. of course, the council itself probably needs to review it too and see where.
I mean, the timing then was real bad because of where the economy was.
Right.
Now it might be the time to.
Well,
talking about it,
I do know there is also talk about a potential community college district also, so that's,
yeah.
So, you know, putting two funding
on
things on a ballot at the same time also gets complicated.
Well,
so.
Yeah.
So anyway, it's on there. I'm not sure how you prioritize that, but we can come back to kind of when we kind of put our priorities on it. But I think in the meantime, that doesn't mean you can't convene and work with existing groups and identify projects and then also research and apply for funding to implement those projects. And so there's kind of, that's the next step to where does the funding come from?
Yeah. To me, that's why we need to continue to work with our partners to have them utilize our parks that we have. I mean, we're doing that a lot more now with the proactive approach with the Little League to get an actual contract that's, either what was a verbal contract or at least a, you know, something more in writing And then with how we're going to structure that contract, it will open up the opportunities for other, you know, other groups to use the parks, and then they'll be maintained longer, and therefore they'll be better longer. But just like, you know, we talked about the pool park up here and the tennis court, and using half of it at least for a basketball area.
Yeah, that tennis court, I don't know if it gets used much now, but it hasn't scored a lot of light on me. It's in pretty bad shape, I think.
Well, the tough part about our community is that, you know, there's not a lot of basketball court areas for the kids.
There isn't.
I mean, the school that hasn't maintained their area inside the fence for a long time.
Never good.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, and this is a place where kids are already going to be, you know, especially with the lunch in the parks. It'd be nice to see them used there, because they have quite a good turnout, I think, this year with opening that up for the lunch program. That was the first.
So is that where you have your lunch, summer lunch?
We have numerous locations. It used to only be like one or two, and now we have quite a few, and the turnout was pretty good. Four locations, well, including in Pine Creek. But, you know, and to have that as a place where people could go.
So does your health committee also have some initiatives that they're trying to promote? Is that part of this partnership?
Yeah, they're helping run the.
Okay.
Or.
Lunch in the parks program.
Organ.
Okay.
Yeah.
Outback.
Outback Strong.
Yeah, they are the ones that actually do the volunteers organization.
Okay.
Because I knew you had a Outback Strong, I like that.
So part of this then is, it's not your coming up with new ideas, it's more us. And the contracts, who are you the owners of the facilities then?
We own the property.
Okay.
But Little League have the usage of it.
Okay.
But that's just Little League. Oh, yeah, okay, you're talking.
So if you're contracted, you have contracts already developed or things, you're working on that, okay.
Well, and like for the Sir Optimus Park, I know, you know, the golf groups down there and that. I know we have a contract with people.
P&L, but yeah, they still own the property there.
You know, we don't have a contract with, probably with the swim team, but they're the primary user for the pool, you know, during the day, every day, and then tournaments, swim meets.
We had a contract with the Saturday market for several years that they're from that.
Do you have an active Saturdays market?
Well, we have had, it's kind of there iffy this year as far as I know. I don't really know what's going on.
Before they were, yeah, they had to move locations only because we were doing the project, so now they're back here probably.
Right, and I just had got word that they want to up their contract and they want to move it back over where it was.
Sounds great.
Yeah, it didn't work out too well around here.
Yeah, it's tough, it's just too small.
So roughly what you're kind of doing is clustering a lot of these outdoor activities in the summer or spring months around a combination of things.
What we've done is like, they actually rent the property of the Saturday market for the Saturday market times once a week, and they pay us $1 a year for the rental, and they have to have their own insurance, liability insurance on them.
And there is a manager for that organizes all that?
Yeah, they have their own manager.
So when we talk about the master plans for the park and that kind of thing, that was a county ran thing. We did bring community partners in, but we as a town, I don't think we have a parks master plan. I know I've never seen one.
Do you have something? Your own plan?
There might be something in our comp plan that talks about what we have, but.
An actual plan of our own making.
Yeah, and then to actually prioritize, because that plan hasn't been looked at probably in years. It'd be nice to look at it again, because I know for me, I've always wished that there were more, or just some equipment at this park here, at the pool park. Because, you know, when we do have activities, or when there is lunch in the park, what are you going to go to? No one goes to this location.
Remember the gentleman that came here from the hospital and wanted to put it in the park? But this park, but the pool would be a much better place for that equipment that they have, because the Sir Optimus Park is not really too ideal for kids.
Yeah, the mosquitoes are terrible.
Mosquitoes are terrible in the spring, and also there's like no picnic tables.
So really, updating the city's parks master plan is something that would need to be looked at and maybe prioritized.
Yeah.
Or developed.
Or developed, yeah.
Yeah.
And we'd really have to sit down with our community partners, because, you know, we need to see if they're willing to even just discuss the idea of integrating that organization.
It would really be nice to put some money into how that looks up there, because, I mean, it's, you know, we do hold, it's a big tourism thing, we have our events, you know, it could really be a lot nicer than it is.
Yeah.
And, you know, the parking's always an issue, and, you know, we let people camp there during the weekends and stuff, which is really, really cool. We actually.
Close out the street.
Put a tent up, we don't sleep there, but.
Yeah.
It's not, it's dry camping, though.
Yeah, it's not dry camping, yeah.
It's quite beautiful.
It gets pretty packed.
Okay, so, a lot of scribbles here, but I think there's a lot of kind of snicks of steps that need to be taken, and we'll kind of formalize those and put them in. Anything else on the recreation side of things, or the parks and?
You know, we do have a great trail above town on Lakeview property, up Bullard Canyon, that is, it's known by a lot of hikers and bikers here.
Right.
Not many people from out of town, I don't think, utilize it, and it's like a 5-mile trail.
So signage?
Well, and I think they're working on that.
Are they?
That's flyer, it's called Noni's Trail.
Yeah.
And they've got it, you know, they're gonna have it in several places, so.
Is that part of the rural tourism projects that they're working on, Gina?
I don't know if it's rural.
Is it the trail committee?
Trails committee, yeah.
There's some signs in there.
For some of these trails.
There's some signs.
They never were put up. I know, and I thought about the other night.
Yeah, there's signs, yeah, that's why.
That we need to get those signs up, because the Forest Service paid for those.
And they're just sitting in there.
Well, that's one of the things I was gonna say, you do have a great partner potential with the Forest Service, because that is the sort of thing.
They have us with that trail and.
I think we should mention that to our little trails group, too, that we have these signs and we need to get them.
Yeah, because Ray was always going to get the town committee, but it never happened.
I don't know why.
So, install signs.
Yeah.
Install signs we've had for 10 years.
Okay.
We'll be thought about it. I mean, those signs are not.
I've heard from folks that have come here, just, you know, for meetings and things, that they've hiked that trail, and that it's a great, it's a great place, because they can just stay, just walk from their hotel rooms, go on a hike, and then go to dinner, and.
I think it's getting more, you know, I think people are, they're gonna have trail maps, and, you know, the more of that promotional stuff, I think it's gonna, they're gonna use them a lot.
Yeah, and it is actually part of the town itself, it's on your property?
It is on our property.
And that's, I'm glad Mike said always, because especially for the lodgers tax stuff, it'd be nice to know really clearly how much can go towards stuff like this, because, I mean, I think they should come in and request a little bit of funding to put up some signs for, you know, it's part of our tourism portfolio that should be advertised and
so
you know, continue to be.
So as long as it's related to the tourism, on those things that are tourism kind of related, like the signs.
We've got a growing pot of money that needs to start getting priorities.
You have a committee that's working on that?
We do, yeah. Okay. Well, not very far, but we're trying to. Yeah.
Okay. All right, so let's talk about. Community revitalization and housing rehab. Under this one, I did note partnering with LCP and others on especially the downtown revitalization work. There is an Oregon Main Street meeting scheduled coming up in May. I think that LCP will be inviting the town and other all of the groups to come together to really develop a bigger vision for that, the downtown revitalization. So that is the lead. Do you think, is there someone who is a liaison to that here, or?
Not yet.
Is that your role, is to have a liaison with that, or is it, or you want a more active role?
I think with a liaison there, we could probably get more out of it than they can report back, and we can just take it from there and decide what.
L-A-I-S-A-I-N.
That's
a hard one. I never can remember.
That's close enough.
There are a few words that still telling me when I'm standing in front of a blackboard. It's like, oh. Okay. So on some of that, what the other thing we talked about, though, was looking at the tools and the incentives programs. So that is an educational process, I think, at first. Is that really kind of where I see it? Is that what you think you need, is to educate yourself on what incentives and tools are out there?
I would think, for me, it is.
Well, especially with some of the new changes.
Okay.
We need to really kind of get up on the regulations of what we can and can't do anymore.
Do you have ordinances that need to be looked at, or is that something you want to put on the table now, or?
We need to.
Ordinances
are horrible.
Okay. So review and update.
Oh my gosh, yeah.
If we found candy from like 20 years
that's
ago,
I'm sure throwing out
ordinances are worse.
It isn't. My mom does think that all government should have a rule that before they make another rule, they got to throw one out.
That is so true.
So.
And then they counteract.
Well, I think this group is, our current council is willing and ready to look at some of the old ordinances.
We've talked about it kind of and just haven't really.
Each meeting we should raise you one.
Yeah, yeah.
That's actually a great idea.
It could be a work session.
Yeah. Just say every work session that we have.
Pull a few out.
That's a great idea.
Do you need this in order? Can we even implement it?
Yeah.
Do you have the funds to implement it?
Is
it worth our time
anymore?
To try to even?
What changes do we need to make from these old ones that have been around for a long time?
Do you start that internally and then get input from the community?
Well, the nice thing is with the new police contract, we've got them as a, you know, kind of code enforcement folks.
Yes.
It's in the contract. So it'd be nice to have them involved with that.
Yeah.
You got something, Mike?
I probably shouldn't enter into the.
No, you're good. It's a work session.
Well, I feel like there's places that I shouldn't, but I would make a comment to the council that. The Lakeview Community Partnership was formed as a Main Street organization. There should be a strong organization for the revitalization of downtown Lakeview. I think that it's heading its own direction, but downtown revitalization I don't think has been seen since its formation some four years ago. So perhaps the town council who supported the Main Street endeavor should take a look at the Main Street endeavor again and see what Main Street and what the initial impact of what you were looking for is and where you're wanting to head. So,
I definitely hear you on that. It'll be interesting to know what happens once that project's complete, where they go. Because maybe they'll finally not focus on the.
On one building.
Well, there's a lot of disgruntled people in Lakeview in regards to the Main Street program as it was established, and I think that the majority of them are right here on Main Street.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
So.
Well, we've had some subgroups, it sounds like.
Are we a liaison to the board?
I was asked to join them.
Well, just to all of us. Are we liaison to the LCP?
I don't think we have a member that has
Yeah, I talked to Ann and I discussed some stuff and I went with her to Serapis and we talked about it a bit, which I'm happy to.
Yeah, it'd be nice to.
And we need to.
Keep a presence on that group, just like you say, I mean, to help bring it back to, hey, you know, putting all your eggs in one basket is kind of spread out here.
And I thought there was going to be somebody from Main Street again because there's some funding.
That's the May 9th meeting. That's why I put that date up there. That is when, and I'm blanking on her name, but the state sheriff from the Main Street program. And that's, they want to kind of look at the bigger picture of that meeting.
And I'll speak for myself, but I think I could speak for all of us. No one's putting that group down. They're doing a great job of what they're doing. A very good job, but it would be nice to.
Cheers to it, yes.
Get some of the projects done.
But our Main Street hasn't really improved at all for the last several years.
Okay.
That's.
Which street do you consider Main Street?
East Street, this one.
That's what I thought, but.
Yeah.
You also have.
Well, Main Street, the highway, but yeah.
Well, it may encourage more businesses to get in there.
They sometimes call this, what is it, Old Town Lakeview or Downtown Lakeview or something like that. And so I think that's basically where Main Street used to be.
So that, as far as the hub.
I guess it's, it was at one time mostly the main business street. That's why I think we call it that. That's why I call it that.
Okay, because, you know, there's.
Because there was a hardware store when we moved here.
Well, yes.
At least three or four little grocery stores right now.
I think in the initial Main Street discussions, Main Street is the community proper. And the downtown district, business district, which is drawn out in our business plan, our planning department plan for the town of Lakeview, incorporates the two streets that you're speaking of, 395. And luckily, the downtown revitalization on 395 was covered by the Oregon Department of Transportation with the lighting and grants that were received in that regard. But the continuity that was looked for and talked about in the initial Main Street joining that organization and heading forward was talking about incorporating the entire two streets together to where they looked and you felt like you were in the same community, not driving from one town to another, stepping off the side street. So
this is a term, do you actually have a defined downtown business district?
I don't know.
You can talk, Janine would have the information, because when we looked at the marijuana locations, it was very heavily discussed in regards to what the downtown business district was looked at. It also, it goes over to G, which includes, it's more, G was looked at as more of a office or medical type.
Yeah, I was going to say services, yeah.
But these two streets right here that are on both sides of us were considered, and that this, the adjoining streets.
Right.
Are considered the main downtown area.
How far is that one?
So this kind of, this effort, you know, in various communities, that, you know, there is now an active downtown association that is self-funded and things like that. But, you know, it is kind of, I think the role that I know when I first came here that I couldn't talk about this stuff because there was several groups. But I think people are starting to work together better on this, so I think it is a time to really kind of look at moving forward.
You know, Occupy East Street, you know, Mike Beeson spent a lot to go to East Street, which is great, so, and given us money, you know, so.
Yep.
And he's working with the other businesses as well as revitalizing that street itself. The problem, Betty, when you came, I remember when growing up here that somebody wanted to bring in a new business and the people, the businesses in this town did not want it.
Competition?
They did not want the competition.
There's another news story right next to where the marijuana store is up here that's going to be open. I think it's a restaurant.
It's a restaurant.
Really?
I think that's what it is, but it was in history. I'm pretty sure that's what it is.
Well, I do know from a lot of the works that have been done in other communities, a lot of what you have is big buildings that aren't very appropriately sized space for smaller startup type of businesses. So one thing, you know, that can be looked at is kind of how do you, you know, do you have ordinances or whatever that will allow for kind of flexing space? Or, you know, what needs to be done to allow that to kind of, and encourage people that own the buildings?
Because the buildings that are empty are really, really in bad shape.
Yeah.
That's really sad, because some of them are, you know, neat old buildings, but it takes a lot of money to...
It does.
Get them up to standard.
It's sometimes easier to just sit on it and not put the investments in.
That's sad.
So... I have to admit, I don't know exactly what all economic development does, as well as like the chamber and stuff. It would be really nice to get them reaching out to those property owners, kind of helping get the resources to them. And when I say resources, I'm not talking about grants, I'm talking about, you know, some Kickstarter monies, but also some potential buyers and stuff like that.
Right.
Sometimes I think we have... And even current business owners that may want to relocate to a little bit larger or stuff like that. And just knowing, maybe even having a portfolio of what they, or just a white sheet on what they want, what these owners are looking for as in next, leases and stuff like that, these properties. Yeah. It'd be a nice little resource to have a little.
One program that is. Sometimes helps, but it's not really what I think needs to happen here as much as like a facade improvement. But I think it's more inside the buildings where the investments need to be.
Part of the problem is, you know, we need advocates for these leases. You know, like we have somebody comes in and they say, well, I can't afford a $700 a month heating bill.
Right.
Or, you know, I got stuff getting leaked on, and we need somebody to help advocate for them, because while we understand that owners can't necessarily throw money at a building, we also need to make it, you know, feasible.
Well, earlier we talked about our, I think we're in some ways just as guilty because, you know, we got like the Sunshine Center. And I feel bad because we kind of derailed a group that wanted to go in there by maybe not having a building that was ready to go for them and needing to spend some money on it and not having the money to spend ourselves on it. But kind of put us in a tight spot trying to lease to someone who we really couldn't get a decent lease payment out of.
Yeah.
I mean,
well, you know, or just assuming we have to look at what it, you know, gives back to the community alone. If we had a center, I mean, we may not make money on the town side, right, necessarily, but man, what, we have many people. I get a lot of messages constantly. I have an employee who wants to move here. Do you know any childcare providers? Good luck. Yeah. You know, I mean. They can't move here because they don't have housing or childcare. Those are the two big issues I see constantly.
And if we could do really with that building down there, sitting there just wasting money.
I know a potential renter.
Which almost.
Oh,
yeah, well, that would take you
to I was I am working on her. She's almost ready.
Really?
No, she's going to be the first in the town of Lakeview that has licensed as a childcare provider. Uh-huh.
And so that is a challenge in this, in Oregon, is going through that whole licensing.
It has been. Well, I moved here and wanted to work out. I had a terrible time finding
daycare.
I think we could get some, you know, where it is right now, where it's established as a daycare or was, or is
currently,
we can rent it that way.
You'd be a kindergarten.
So who owns the building?
The town.
Yeah.
The town owns it.
And that's the old sun. That's
yep.
The Sunshine.
For $1 a year. So, yeah.
I've got to write old sun. Is Sunshine.
Yeah, that defines it pretty well.
Center, was it?
Building, I guess.
buildings, yeah. Daycare center, whatever you wanna call it, yeah.
So you could potentially encourage an enterprise to go into that as the leasehold, you know, and make put some incentives to do that?
I think.
In order for that to be a daycare again, there's a lot of things that's gotta be changed in.
That's what we've been struggling with. On the state side, there's not a lot of requirements.
Change the toilet, remove the toilet.
State requirements.
But wasn't there the toilets and then?
It just has to be functioning. I mean, they don't have to have ADA yet. Because most of these homes that people are doing care in don't even meet state requirements.
What I'm talking about, the steps and stuff.
They're not required ADA.
But I'm going by what the building inspector and what the state fire marshal said.
Well, yeah, to bring it up to code as a usable building, yeah, yeah.
That's why I'm saying it's gotta be changed to bring it up to code in order to be used.
And that's pretty much it, from my understanding.
And that won't be cheap.
I know, but it's been.
Mike would remember, didn't we put a bunch of money into it before, some years ago?
We did, and then there were two people that utilized it after that money went in. Of course, one of them was the.
Handicap ramp.
Head starter, not heads.
YMCA.
YMCA.
YMCA when they wanted to use it.
They utilized it because it had to be retrofitted.
I don't remember how much money, but we did put some money in.
The ramp put in the back.
Making it better and up to their standards.
What was the estimate on that, do you think? We never did get.
I never did get an estimate. We kept waiting. But all the builders around here were so tied up and booked so far out.
I've thought about trying to, you know, get grants for some of the, because I have a provider and a preschool teacher that would love to utilize it together, not necessarily in the same ownership or management. And I thought, man, if we could get some grants for these guys to put into it.
With the new Oregon preschool.
Preschool promise.
Yeah. There might be some opportunities.
Yeah, we've got some discussions going on right now, because there's.
Because that is the, you know, the wanting to start them at what, age four at least, or three?
Three.
Three?
No.
So.
Yep.
There may be a partnership with some state.
Going to school.
Yeah. That's my first career.
Same, that's one of mine, but.
I have a degree in early childhood education.
Yes. It's one of those I'm very torn, because some studies show that early education is worse, some better. I've had kids in both aspects and still wait and see how that experiment turns out.
Okay, so we have. You have a long list of things that you want to make a difference on, so that's great. I'm going to talk more about housing now, because that was the other one that I think we need to flesh out a little more of what.
Yeah. And the Brownsville?
And part of that, yes, is the Brownsville project, and the potential there is that we can do some redevelopment planning with some of that money. So the housing, there is the housing needs analysis
is happening
right now. That's supposed to be done by June.
Yeah. Consultant's work will be done by June. Our work will probably be followed up on July, August.
As part of our contract with Cardinal, who is the consultant working with us on the Brownsville, they are coming in and doing a market analysis component to that study. So that would be under the Brownsville, and that's paid for.
So these things are like huge, I think, because you also got your economic opportunities analysis going on.
Right. Which also.
Which all this stuff ties in together.
Also points to the workforce.
Everything's ready for what's about to happen. So.
That's the EOA, and that is, I think, will have something on workforce housing in it too, right? I've tried it. Make sure it was mentioned several times. The other, you know, just the other part of that is so where we're looking at it from the full perspective. From your perspective, if you could put in 30 new houses, Would it be multifamily housing? Would it be single-family homes? Would it be cluster housing or all of the above?
All of them.
I think you need some kind of balance between them.
Okay.
I think it's part of looking at what we have. Like, when I look at some of, you know, when I think of multifamily, I often think of just Section 8 housing and stuff like that. So, knowing their waiting list and knowing how full they always are is kind of key to knowing an answer to that. Because if they have any vacancies, that's telling me that we don't need any more of that type of housing.
Well,
no, I don't see anybody outside of low income wanting to live in an apartment.
That's what I was wondering.
There's lots.
Do you think there is a need for just condo, what I call condo living?
We have short-term fire guys,
right,
which never have housing. We have college students, my own child.
I know some people remember in rooms.
Yeah.
We have people at the hospital that come here for 6 months.
Therapists.
And my therapist, I'm going right now, so yeah, they have a heck of a time finding a place to rent.
No, they want affordable housing that is low maintenance, so, you know, they don't have their backyard.
They don't want to bring their lawnmowers, they don't want to bring all that, yeah.
And that could be duplexes.
Yeah, duplex or something, but I guess that's where the term multifamily, I'm thinking apartment building, but yeah, duplex, I guess, could be considered. It's not considered in my mind.
Oh, I just have them take my tenants. There's three of them, one north, one south, and one.
Yeah, that.
Commons.
Yeah, the commons.
Those are the Climate Housing Authority facilities, yeah. Those are continually full, correct?
Never empty, from my understanding.
Yeah, I think they are.
So have you had conversations with the Housing Authority about if they have, are they looking to this community to do more?
No, we need, you and I have a discussion.
Yeah, we do, yeah.
Because I mentioned her on my other group.
They finished up when I was here before, so about 04, 05.
I was going to say probably 15, 16 years.
They were here, that's, they were finished up.
Great to see how they could get something like that built in.
And that's why.
But not quite the style.
No, low roof, low ceilings.
We need a presence on that board. I mean, when I say somebody in this community, where they service our community, we need a presence on that board.
But that old mill site down there, put a lot of houses down there.
Yes, you could.
Plus, you could take part of that out and put in another grocery store.
Well, it's on the list. Matter of fact, Ginger and I had a conversation with a site selector. He basically works across the United States on identifying industrial and other uses for communities and helps bring companies to it in. And so we had a conversation about, and we did bring up the grocery store. Said, I can't have a conversation unless I talk about having, you know, options.
Well,
grocery store options.
The other thing, you know, when I say grocery store, I like to see one in here with a pharmacy, because Jeff has been begging for another pharmacy to come in here.
You're Howard's?
Yeah.
Really?
He said they were so overworked.
Okay.
Well, I mean, even.
They're running over one another and everything else in there.
Most of the Safeways was updated, and ours couldn't reasonably even shut down, you know, portion to update theirs. I'm sure they would probably love it as much as, you know, we would, but they couldn't.
I wish you would talk to Holiday Market.
Richie!
Sometimes I would drive to Alturas to go to that store.
Have you been to the one in?
I have not been to the one in Klamath.
Yeah, it's right behind my office. I run over there for lunch all the time. The thing about Holiday Market, we had one where I lived in California outside the gated community. It was the only grocery store within. I had to still drive 3 miles to get to it, but it was within, because there was nothing inside the apartment. But my daughter's first job was at Holiday's Market. You know, she was still just out of high school. She worked as a clerk there.
It's a nice store.
Yeah.
Is it in Alturas?
Mm-hmm. See, like a grocery and store? That's another thing. You get a market in here.
Just go straight to the
for kids.
Lights.
Oh yeah.
It's about a mile.
Now, how come
Bridge just got a grocery outlet?
Is it affordable?
Grocery outlets.
Well, yeah. Their prices are probably fairly compatible to what we have as Albertsons, which is the same type of thing as Safeway.
Oh, wow.
They're higher in meats and higher in vegetables.
Population is the same as it always is.
And a lot of, a large beer wine section, and then they have a pharmacy in the side.
Which one's that one?
The one over in Clamath Falls. They have, but their pharmacy is run by the Skylights Medical Center.
Oh, is it?
So they lease it out. So that's separate from the housing conversation, I know. However, all these conversations are going on at once. That, I think part of the Brownsfield really is where we can vision the reuse of those properties and what the goal is. And I did bring flyer, I'm leaving with everyone. The goal is really to identify, you know, those properties, what constraints they have now that may be either perceived or real contaminations, to clean them up, and then to redevelop the sites and to find potential investors and users for those sites. And what I see for that old lumber mill site is the potential mixed use. So is there a role that you need to play if that is a potential? Is that allowable now? Is that something that, you know, that site is zoned commercial? Could it be commercial housing?
Is that down past Snack Shack? Like, is that Bob's place?
The dark purple.
This
one
right there.
Purple?
Industrial, commercial.
Subdistrict.
Where's that at?
Yeah, industrial, commercial.
So anyway, on April 9th at 6 p.m. in the commissioner's hearing room, we're having a meeting with the Brownsfield consultant and EPA folks to talk some more about that program. So
tomorrow?
April.
April.
So.
And at what time?
6 p.m.
That'll be after our regular meeting.
Yep. So.
Easy reminder to get to the next meeting.
Yeah.
That used to be a.
So part of, I guess, is your engagement in some of these processes at this point in time, and then identifying after that what the next steps are, but also being open to, if there are people who want to invest now, do you have a plan or something that they could start on?
Too weedy. Bring me the money.
Okay.
Sure.
I can't really water. I can just build so much stuff.
All right, we got two more, actually. Just keep going up here. So the one is the partnering with the economic and regional organizations around workforce and other issues. So that's kind of it's not necessarily something you'd lean on, but. Have you ever had the Regional Solutions team come to the town council meeting?
I believe so.
There's been a lot of members, Larry and a lot of members that have been here.
That have come, but not.
Not a ton of team, so.
Yeah.
So part of what you talked about the last time was the desire to have KCC's workforce folks come and talk to you about what they're doing. The Small Business Development Center coming to visit with you. Do I need to make a SCOA presentation sometimes so people actually know what we do?
That's pretty fun.
I sometimes, you know, forget that. There's some days I don't know what I'm doing. Anyway. Regional Solutions? I think the importance for you here is knowing who to call and when, you know, and and so there's really, there are a lot of resources that the more aware you are of kind of that network that's out there, I think it helps you be able to, you know, when you've got businesses with issues or things like that, to be referred to the right folks. Are there other things?
And we can't do that unless we know what they are. Because you're always seeing all these initials and going, what the heck is that?
Yes. I could do a whole half hour on nothing but initials.
Well, I think the good thing though, too, is we know because of you, you know, and SCOED and SCOACT, and I think that we know at least we can contact you, get us in the right direction if we didn't know where to go.
This is the Small Business Development Center.
Sure. Car getting repossessed.
I had to look at that pickup, same color as mine, but it's a Dodge.
Is that yours getting paid?
Yeah, I was looking.
I woke up yesterday morning, got in my car, drove to the end of the street on a flat tire.
Oh, no. Ruined your tire?
I did.
Oh, no.
So I had to go, I actually drove back to my house and I called AAA because I didn't realize how flat it was until I got, I'm going, the car is clumping here. Shouldn't be doing it. Anyway, so I had the tow truck come and put my spare tire on, then had to go sit for 2 hours at the tire place.
No.
Yeah, so anyway, that was my yesterday. Where are we? Lost. Okay, so a lot of what this is really is to kind of identify what resources are out there and to just, the other part of that though, and that was where I wanted to go with this, is you could work through some of these types of things. You've talked a lot about identifying business needs. One way you could do that is through like a business retention expansion survey, which some communities do. You know, it's kind of a formalized approach, or just a business survey, which could come under the umbrella of the town itself, if you wanted, in partner with others. You open yourself up to asking what they want, need, and then identifying and maybe having to find ways to meet those needs, but it is one way that potentially you could kind of get to and identify more of those specific issues. And even back onto the revitalization you talked about, you know, what is it the businesses need as far as space and things like that. So a formal way of doing that is kind of a business retention expansion, is what they call it, a BRE. So that is a potential of something you could do and work in partnership with SCOED or others on something like that. The other thing I had, you had mentioned like the succession planning workshops and or, so that's kind of a partnership, because I think the Small Business Development Center does do that type of thing, or they're, you know, handing, how do you sell your business even? It may not be, you know, retirement, but you may need to move on. You need help selling your business to someone else. So all of that things are things that you can talk to the Small Business Development Center about, programs that they might have already in place that they could bring to this community and you could sponsor in partnership with them. So those were some of the thoughts I was having on that. Anything else that you want to? Okay, and the last one then was air quality.
When you said on business survey, what in particular would you ask for?
I've done several of them in the past where you asked how long they've been in business. Are they looking to expand, contract? Do they need assistance in financing? Do they need assistance in employment, you know, finding employees? Do they need assistance in different marketing or different types of things? It's kind of a very standard type of questionnaire. You can make it like a two-pager, or I've done some that were a lot more than that. You can do it as just like a Survey Monkey survey, or you could do it as a one-on-one back in California I did do this once where two people did go out and visit. You set up the appointments and you went and literally sat down with the business owner and went through the questionnaire and asked them and identified. And the reason two people go is that you usually have like another business person, like someone from the chamber and a an elected official of some sort or someone from the government. So you kind of have both perspectives. And sometimes people don't like to do that type. They're more willing to just do the survey kind of thing. So it depends on what you think this community is ready for at this point in time. The 101, we did mostly with industrial type of businesses, you know, more. And Ginger, part of her job is to make sure she touches base with businesses on a regular basis, your major employers, because we want to make sure we can't afford to lose them. So just leave it at that. So that, you know, those are all options of how you might do it. So, you know, you can think about what approach you think might work here, but you can do kind of that formalized surveying rather than just envelope and have that information. Then you can put a report out and then identify maybe some key things you could work on that would make a difference. So that's a tool that, you know, you could use.
Thank you.
All right, and on the air quality side, let's go back to this. Do we have some specific tasks that needed to be added to that, or is it just continuing what you're doing, which is... Have you ever done a learn to burn workshop here?
A learn to burn?
Learn to burn.
As in,
for those people who actually have wood stoves, right. Do they? You know, a lot of the issue is that they're burning wet or they're not burning properly.
Okay.
So a learn to burn workshop is, we actually, Pam applied for some funding, but it didn't get funded, but we're still looking. We could potentially look for something along those lines for a grant that you could bring some folks in that can teach people how to make sure that they're not
burning wet.
And yeah.
Well, and during the air quality meeting, they talked a little bit about the meter, so you can check the wood quality.
We've talked about using some of the mining built shelters over some of these folks that don't have it.
Okay.
Wood.
So wood. Wood sheds.
Yeah, I think, I mean...
Wood shelters. Okay.
Are we talking about something other than going back to the goal?
Yeah, did you find the goal?
Well, no, so it wasn't in the plan.
Okay.
The mission statement, anything like that. But it's really just continue supporting the PM 2.5... what's the
word? PM Advanced Plan.
PM Advanced. Mm-hmm.
And that plan has specific action. All right, so you've got enough work for full-time jobs. This is a part-time job for most of you. So if you had to prioritize the top three that you want to make sure get started on and get worked on first, I didn't bring blue dots. So you're gonna have, I'll just have to, we'll just have to go through this.
I think the water one is obviously a big one for us.
Number one is water.
Okay. I think we probably all agree on that one.
Okay, we had a lot of discussion around parks. We had a lot of discussion around housing. And so is there a kind of a first step that we want to really make sure that there's identifying kind of some actions to work on?
See, right now on the water, we've already got the paperwork going, so it's just a timely process right now.
In the follow-through.
So you also talked about looking at your ordinances and starting to do that, so work sessions and working on work sessions to do ordinances. You talked about getting together with community partners around the use of space and really looking at your working on a city master plan. Is that something you want to start in the next month, the next 6 months, kind of?
About 20 years from now.
20 years from now?
His kids are all council.
That's what they usually do, and it's like so frustrating.
I think the, the water thing, I think there just needs to be, I know we're early on in the stage, but make sure we get the public's buy-in of what this really means, because, I mean, you're going to have a lot of people going, because there's a lot of silent, maybe majority out there that says, yeah, we wish it was better, but do we want to pay $20 a month more? They may say, forget that, it ain't going to get better. You know, so, and that's the worry I have on this whole thing, is that we're spending a lot of time on this, and it's like, we don't know the public's true perception of this, in my opinion. I mean, we had a lot of people who were upset, but we were also in a drought for 5 years, you know, with only one good year mixed in those 5 years.
So you really need to have some more public.
Yeah, it's a matter of, yes, we got to apply for grants and all that, but then it's like,
and
when it comes down to it, are we going to just pull the trigger?
Are you working with RCAC? They provide some of that at no cost to you, don't they? So RCAC, I think, that offered to do some public.
They are, I met with them.
I think a lot of it is the, honestly, I think it's a relationship issue. I think a lot of people 100% want clean water. I don't think too many people both are paying a little extra. I just think they need to trust that it's going to happen and see the timeline of when it's going to happen.
And there's got to be assurance.
I just was going to say your problem this year is going to be that they're going to have good clean water going into the summer, and they're going to say.
Because of the.
We'll have the swamp, the spring water that comes from Bullock Canyon is good. I think Jeff said it might go through July into August this year with all the snowpack.
So.
And with the wells that have been upgraded. That's the thing about it. There's been things that have been done on our water supply that the public's not going to be an easy sell on a bump up in their water rates.
Well, there's other groups that are looking, you think about adding the Park and Rec District, that's more taxing. You know, I think about what the schools may be under and, need to revitalize some of their own buildings and stuff. So, I mean, there's a lot of things out there that it's all about timing, and it's all about where the county, or not the county, but where the citizens really want to get. Put their dollars, so to speak. To me, I mean, I think of our parks as number one. I mean, really, what we can provide for people here, and I'd like to see, more equipment, like I said, up here, and, the splash park, something changed there, and there may be options that we just haven't explored and looked at, but, get a kind of an idea, at least amongst ourselves, and then, asking the community what they'd like to see most would be.
I think we, if we wanted to even do something like put out something people could, not an actual election, but they could make their choices and turn them into us. Which one of these, and if your water bill's going to go up $20, which one?
Well, John Day actually did do a survey, a community survey, working with some organization that they had to come in and help them do that. That might be something, when you...
What need?
Yeah, what need or prioritize of communities, because, you've talked, as you mentioned, you've talked about, a lot of things that would, I'm sure everyone in the community would like, but then there's a dollar figure that they would actually have to help with, too.
We've talked about the hospital, and I'm not overstepping any announcements or anything, but they've talked about doing an indoor pool themselves. And so it's like, well, if they're going to possibly go that route, what should we even be considering doing ours? I mean, if they're going to have that in any way available to the public, not just their patients, then we have probably have no business thinking about trying to put a couple of this. We wouldn't need two in one community. So,
are they thinking about letting it public though?
I don't know for sure, but.
I mean, would it be like a Olympic sized pool that they can have?
I don't know. I'm just saying, I think that's why we need to bring everybody together to develop really a Lakeview Parks and Rec kind of plan. And you'd have people like Charlie on that group.
Mike?
I raised my hand again, and I'm sorry to keep jumping in on it, but the thoughts in regards to the monies that are set aside for community service, it was once hoped amongst some of those in the county and the town that those monies would be utilized for something as what you're speaking of, a concerted effort where the school chipped in money or provided the property for, or the hospital and the two entities, governmental entities, the county, which has a lot of Red Rock money fixing to start flowing once it's open, just as the town of Lakeview does. And those monies, you know, I know they're for your spending and however you see fit, but that's what, I mean, that all needs to be taken into consideration of how you're going to spend and utilize those monies in the future on these projects, because it is going to be real, it looks as though. So that's something that the forethought, and I went through community service discussions with Iberdrola and also with Red Rock, and community service fees are meant to be set aside to serve the public. I mean, that's you're doing it instead of taxes, so therefore some of these projects that you're speaking of, and they're all important to the public, so you know, pick it as counselors. You guys are in charge, and you know, if you can create that, that what needs to be done, the group effort, and then you can have a
like the idea of a survey,
a facility that could could serve the community, and that's where you've always got the people on this side of the fence say, well, no, why do we want to put it in Lakeview? Because all the county kids are going to come use it. Well, we're all a community, and we all should be able to come together and utilize it, but we all need to pitch in. The county needs to pitch in, the town needs to pitch in, the school system, and the hospital, because all can benefit from it, and it could be an excellent facility. And so there's a lot of monies that are on the board that need to be utilized and be thought out in a big way, and that's just one. And I'm sorry, once again.
So I think, you know, you've got a lot of potential work that is all gearing you towards, I think, what your vision. Again, it is just a matter of, and it's not necessarily sitting here today with me, because I think you need to mull it, you need to convene partners even. That may be your first step, was to do some outreach and to bring a group together and have someone facilitate it if you needed to, just kind of really start to prioritize on a community basis, because you're not the only you know ones that are getting down. And you also have limited staff, and you have to make sure that you're not overdoing your own things. The daycare, though, I think if finding out what that would cost might be something that you wanted to do too. So, again,
we have a gal that we've been talking, and I kind of told her, well, you know, if I need to, I can call the contractors and get them out there to get an estimate on that. I just didn't know what, and Jeff did. You guys remember we discussed it. Jeff said that he could meet me there to let them get in access to that building.
So this is a tool I use when I'm doing action planning, and I'm not planning on going through action planning with you guys, but it's called basically just when, who, what, the status, and you know, just it just helps you identify the steps that you need to go through and kind of and assigns a lead. And it could be a liaison person from the council, or you could assign it to staff, but at least you have one person who is the lead, and then somebody else, and then you report back to the group. So it's, I'm going to leave this, I'll send all of these notes, and then you can kind of, I made copies, so. So you can kind of use that as a way to get your thoughts organized around the steps you need to take, and then assign it to someone so that it's not just assuming someone else is doing it. No one is.
So that seems like a really cool exercise to go through on even like a liaison assignment, to really explain what these positions are, when they meet, how frequently.
Mm-hmm.
Who's the contact?
So you guys didn't do liaison at my time?
No, and it's not on our agenda this time.
Can we add it to next week's?
Yeah. Or you want to put in here for my notes down?
Can you just email this to me?
Yes, I can.
He's going to shrink it.
No, I don't want to shrink it.
That's great.
I don't.
I have words so I can fill it out.
I don't even have a PDF fillable maker, but it's a spreadsheet, so I'll send you the spreadsheet.
Yeah, spreadsheet's fine.
Could you, that'd be nice.
Yeah.
So if you send it to me or whatever.
Yeah,
I can redo it real quick, but it's nice.
It's really just an Excel spreadsheet.
I like it.
But it, you know, for me, it's helpful to, I like to think, okay, this is where the end is, and then work my way through to how do you get to the end? And there's always more steps than you think. But
no, this is good. This is really good.
So do you have a website that you can kind of publish at least your vision and mission statements?
Yes,
so,
I do.
So we'll, I think that's a good idea for the community to see that. And then your next steps, it sounds like you will need to start identifying liaisons and who's going to work on projects and stuff. It's good stuff, so.
Okay.
And one thing that is going through the legislature right now is a bill that would fund the economic development districts, which OED is an economic development district, to have a person who's a grant writer and or identify funding for rural communities and help them with that process. So if that bill goes through and the state legislature funds the districts, well, it's not going to be a full-time position, but we may have more resources available to offer through my office as far as.
What number is that?
3110. 3110.
Okay.
So, and also part of our role also with SCOED is to do a lot of the business outreach and stuff. So if you decide you wanted to move ahead with any survey type of work, that is something
like
that we can partner with.
You know, like you said, a lot of people may not want to pay that money, or they may think something else is more important or whatever.
Last year we did was over the public service fee, and we got a lot of response out of that.
I understand that your community actually responds well to Facebook survey, you know, or getting the word out through Facebook. So, but it's not everyone, I'm sure.
Right, right.
So I want to make sure that if you do something, you think through.
Well, it needs to be in several different.
Sources, and also, you know, you have a 12% of your population is Hispanic also, mm-hmm. so you may want to look having some way of reaching out to them also.
Right. But, you know, I think that survey would really help us, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think it would.
Can we put those on the new bills?
Mm-hmm. Or at least
that.
What we do is put, you know.
They're not quite as extensive as all of
them. You know, like put on there, you know, go to this and fill out the survey monkey or whatever, you know. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Because we can add stuff to those.
Pick up a survey or
yep.
put one in the paper for them to come out or
you know, there's lots of different ways to get that.
Yeah.
I think the survey at Yorktown Hall, we thought we'd pick it up.
But we just need to figure out what we want on that.
Well, we, yeah, we need to figure out how to, what we're gonna ask them for.
All right, well, I can follow up with you on that, on helping with that.
In regards to a survey, in regards to that type of, when you're dealing with, you have a very direct market that you're dealing with, just as you say. Those people that are paying the bills right now, that receive those bills, if you do a direct mailing survey that is not the bill, but an actual survey that looks official, you're reaching everyone that's gonna possibly have to pay more. So you're gonna reach those people. You don't have to go out and say, well, will Facebook speak for it? Well, Facebook will just speak a lot of other things, as you know.
Did we get that?
And so, you know, you can open yourself up if you want to, or you can directly market to those that you're gonna impact. Those are the people that receive the bills already.
I don't want to go throw it away. I'm like, don't throw it out, there's money in there. Because they send a notice first. I like the separate ones, because I'm one of those that read when we get the bigger bills for the water. And I read them, and even then I still perused over the Survey Monkey thing, just out of habit. But I like the idea of sending a separate bill, or a separate notification. I mean, I know it's spending, but.
Well, if you use Facebook or Survey Monkey, you're gonna have people that, I mean, they're not the ones paying the bill, but they're sure gonna voice their opinion. And so.
But if we did, you know, and we can do that anytime, a separate billing, you know, so.
Yeah, that's a good thought.
I'm not suggesting a $2 bill, but that was cool.
It was cool.
Yeah.
And that was on what?
Outback Strong on the opioid.
Oh.
Opioid, what was it called? The center.
Was it the survey too?
Mm-hmm. They sent out a notice first saying that we would be getting one in the mail, and there was money in there, so don't throw it out, basically. Then they sent one out about 2 weeks later, I think, and yeah, it was addressed to my husband. He was on an opioid use or something like that.
That was pretty heavy.
All right, I will take these notes and put them into a kind of a long list of potential activities.
Okay, maybe.
And get back to you.
Yeah, that's good.
Anybody have anything else for Betty?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, appreciate it very much.
And I left the Brownsville, there's two, there's one's a flyer for the meeting, and there's one just kind of a what the Brownsville is, so.
Okay.
If you don't take it, put them up by the front desk or something.
Before you adjourn, can I just got asked about something. I just forwarded it to Roberta. Got an email from an organization about wanting to use the town parking lot for a walk slash run for suicide awareness prevention. So obviously, I just wanted to bring it up to everyone's attention, is like that way they can know where they're, what they need to do to use that town parking lot. But apparently, it's being used for parking. Possibly right now.
They've been using it for parking.
Mm-hmm. So is it? I haven't noticed. So I don't know. Is it being used?
When did they want it?
April.
I think they need to come to council.
Yeah.
Well, and I just sent the email for next week's meeting, and they've gotten ODOT's approval. Date on here.
Yeah,
I think it's like April 19th.
You think you just respond, have them come to Tuesday's meeting?
Yes.
Yeah, they need to come to council meeting on that.
If they have anything they want.
We'll have to figure out some way to.
That's plenty of time, though.
Yeah, put it out before people want to park.
Send it forward to Jeff, too.
Well,
they
put something up on the driveway to have prevent cars from going in.
Okay. I just didn't, yeah. That was one of the questions. They've got a map and everything, yeah. They've got it organized. I just didn't know anything about that lot right now. Yeah.
So before, when we were dealing with, you know, requests like this to close roads, we checked with, obviously, roads, but with utility group, but, you know, our police chief usually is involved, so now we're just going to send it to the sheriff.
I already sent it to the sheriff as well. They aren't asking for a CO. assistance necessarily, but I haven't even reviewed it all, but I figured we'd add to next week's agenda. I think that maybe one of them will be here, but I'm not 100% sure. Because they have little ones at home.
If we have nothing else, we will adjourn the meeting at 4:48.
Good.